Good afternoon, respected faculty members, honorable registrar, sir, students, and dear friends. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome Professor Sukhadeo Thorat, who is an eminent economist, social thinker, educationist, and chairman of the Indian Council of Social Sciences Research. Professor Thorat has done extensive research in the area of problems of excluded groups, socially inclusive growth, poverty, agriculture growth in dry agriculture, caste and economic discrimination, labor market discrimination, impact of economic discrimination on poverty and marginalization, and on economic ideas of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and higher education. He has published over 20 books and more than 100 research papers. As a former chairman of the UGC, he assisted the government in formulating various educational schemes for marginalized communities in the country and has extensively contributed to the civil rights movement against undesirability and caste discrimination. Now I would like to call upon Dr. Vinod to kindly facilitate the guest. Thank you, sir. The issue of reservation has been debated and construed politically and academically since its inception. In the recent times, various communities have claimed the status of backward classes in order to receive the benefits of reservation policy. At the same time, many factions of Indian society have equivocally opposed reservation policy. Many proponents who support this policy and who oppose this particular policy often defend their respective sides without adopting a correct legal or academic discourse. We as academicians and future lawyers of the country must be well informed about this issue on reason and logic rather than on emotions. In order to enable debate and discussion on this partial issue, they have organized this talk to bring out the myths and realities and arguments against reservation. Without taking much of your time, I would now invite Professor Thorat to kindly deliver the talk.
So happy to be here. What I am going to discuss today is the contemporary issue of the sort of growing demand of reservation by various classes of the society. Very complex, very surcharged issue, very difficult issue. But nevertheless, we have to address it. And therefore, what I will do is, I won't focus as much on the argument against reservation, as much on the, as to how reservation policy has emerged in India, why it has emerged, so what is the reason that we have this policy, and what are the arguments that are made from time to time. Why is it that the policy which began with scheduled caste in 1937 and for tribe in 1950 got extended to OBC in 2008, and that there is a growing demand by various sections in the society. Dalit Christian are asking for reservation, Dalit Muslim are asking for reservation. Now Jat, Maratha and Patel ask for reservation. Women ask for the political reservation for the last 10 years. Why is it that there is a growing demand for reservation by various groups in Indian society. But what's the reason? Therefore, I will look into these all issues because this is a national concern, national problem, and we must address it. I am not a student of law, and therefore I won't go into the legal aspect of it, but I will certainly go into the social and political aspect of it. Let me give you the history, and then I go to the certain feature of our society. You are aware as a student of law that India was governed by the Government of India Act, which was enacted somewhere around the late 19th century, I think 1817, I don't know the precise year. So under that act we were controlled from London. There was one specific provision in that act, that this act through which the India is being governed, it will be brought for revision after every 10 years. And so the first revision came in 1910, second revision came in 1920, third revision came in 1930, second revision came in 1930, which led to the framing of a 1935 Act and our first election, democratically election 1937. Nothing much happened in 1940 because there was a fast move for independence, so I don't think there were much changes in 1940, you know better than I do. But finally we got the constitution in 1950. If you go back to 1910, nothing much happened in 1910. But the Government of India Act at that time recognized the problems of minorities. There were certain common rules for everybody, the central legislature, the state legislature, nominations, several provisions were there in the Government of India Act. But as far as the minority and certain groups are concerned, there were two, three groups whose problem was recognized. And these were three groups, the Muslims, the Anglo-Indian, and the Christians. These were the three minority groups whose political problem were recognized. And as a result, by 2020 or so, there was a provision for the representation by the government or nomination by the government of the member from the Christian community and Anglo-Indian community, and there was a separate electorate, political electorate for the Muslim. So the need of the minority was recognized, while there was general provision, but the need for minority was recognized. Ambedkar emerged on the scene in 1920. The problem of untouchable was not visible at all at that time. There were some marginal, some laws earlier which talks about equal access to public services and public amenities and public places to the untouchable. But there was, the problem was not visible at all. It was in 1920 that the untouchable began to receive attention. As I shared with you that in 1920 or 1919, after every 10 years the British would come to India, a team would come and seek the opinion of the Indian to bring some changes to the Government of India Act through which the British ruled us. In 1919, South Bureau Commission came. And it is for the first time before the South Bureau Commission, Ambedkar made a presentation about the problem of untouchables. That was the first attempt. The Ambedkar tried and he did not get anything. I discuss his argument later on. He argued that the untouchables are worse than the Muslim and the Anglo-Indians and the Christians by any indicators of development. They deserve the political recognition and that they needed political representation. But the British government, the South Euro Committee, did not agree. What they agreed was only the nomination in the state legislature, not even the center. Since the demand was in Bombay, so they allowed one nomination in the Bombay Assembly. And Ambedkar was the beneficiary of that nomination. In fact, British nominated Ambedkar on the Bombay State Assembly as a what we now we will call member of the state legislature. So Ambedkar was very disturbed that he had put several arguments. So 10 years later, in 1929, again he put up another memorandum. He worked hard for the next 10 years, and again he put up another memorandum, 29, asking for the separate electorate, political reservation through the mechanism of separate electorate. Similarly, on the pattern of the Muslims. Muslim had a separate electorate for quite a time, and he memorandum argument after argument, he tried to prove that the untouchable case was much worse than that of other three minorities. They deserved the political representation. After 1920 to 1929, there were two conferences held in London, and you are familiar with that, London, the Roundtable Conference. The first, the second, and the third. And the third, these all three roundtable conferences then led to the establishment of enactment of 1935 Act, which was a very substantial form of constitution. Ambedkar went to first roundtable conference, went to second, and went to third, and really argued out the case for equal right to the untouchable at that point of time. He didn't talk much about the tribal. Finally, in the third round table, there was a discussion among various minorities, the Sikh, Muslims, Christians, and several others. Gandhiji was there, and there was no unanimous opinion about whether to give political reservation to the untouchable or not, former untouchable or not. And because of this disagreement, the minority groups in the round table conference left that decision to the Prime Minister of Britain at that time. It was the Labour government there. That whatever Prime Minister decides, we will accept it. The Prime Minister announced that yes, I think so wrote a letter after they came back that yes, we grant the separate electorate to the untouchable, similarly on the pattern of the Muslims. Now, separate electorate means what was separate electorate? You are familiar, I believe, with separate electorate. Is that you identify certain constituencies as reserved for the scheduled caste. That new term came at that time. And only the scheduled caste candidate will contest from those constituencies the way it happens today. But the system, separate electorate system, is different than that of present day political reservation. In the separate electorate, it's a double member constituency. A scheduled caste will contest, and the general candidate will also contest. And the scheduled caste will have two votes, one for their own candidate, other for the general candidate. Others will have a right to vote, but only for their own candidate. So it is it's a reserved constituency for the scheduled caste. Prime Minister Act recommended, but Gandhiji opposed vehemently that it would lead to disintegration. Ambedkar argued quite vehemently that if the separate electorate to Muslim and nomination of Christians and Anglo-Indian doesn't lead to disintegration, how come the separate electorate for the untouchable will lead to disintegration or division? Gandhiji didn't listen, went into fast, into death, into air would have journey to. The fast went up almost for 14 days, and finally there was agreement. So in place of separate electorate, political reservation was accepted with a much larger seat in the central and as well as the state assemblies. So political reservation that you see today was granted to the scheduled caste in 1937. And the first election was held in India, 1987, through Andrew Sartre. in the Guna Pact Agreement, where Malviya was the signatory, Gandhiji was the signatory, and many other were signatories, which make the beginning of reservation for the Dalit. There was also a provision there at the end that effort should be made to give some reservation, some preference to the Dalit in employment, public employment, and also effort should be made to improve their educational level. But it was not a policy. When Ambedkar became the law minister at that time, not law minister, sorry, labor minister, during the British period, Ambedkar was a minister along with others. It was called Executive Council. So he was a member of the Executive Council in charge of the labor and irrigation and water and other portfolio. He made use of the provision in the Guna Pact and introduced the reservation in employment, public employment, in 1943. And some provision was made for education development. I am telling you this history to tell you that the reservation in politics and employment and in education was accepted by the government much before we got independence. In 1950. Indian constitution only formalized it, in whichever act, you know better than I do, the number of the article and others. So Indian constitution only formalized it. Indian constitution introduced several provisions then, principle of non-discrimination, principle of equality, and many other provisions which I'll discuss quickly. Now, this is how the story of reservation. At the time of constitution making, then Congress made an argument in favor of tribal that although they are not discriminated based on caste, but they are more worse than the scheduled caste, so they should also be included. So they were included. About the OBC, only the provision was made. There was a lot of debate about OBC, and it was said that a special commission will be set up, and that commission will decide. And eventually that commission decided in 2008 about the OBC, but there was a provision that economically and educationally backward OBC claim will be considered later. Now, why reservation? This is the story now. Now, as I say, there is a growing demand for reservation by many sections of the society. OBC came, and then now there are others who want to have OBC status, like Jat, Marathas, Patel, and others. And a woman who wants political reservation. There is informal reservation for women in education institutions and many other areas. Not a formal, but informal. Why reservation policy? And what is reservation policy? And what is the justification? Now, this is the issue that I'll discuss a bit. The argument that Dr. Ambedkar, who himself was the chairman of the Doctrine Committee of the Constitution, made several arguments. One of the major arguments that he made was that the former untouchable or Israel untouchable were denied equal right, civic, political, religious and economics, which other enjoy. So there is a denial of equal right or equal citizenship right. And that he is arguing in 1920. And obviously then he has to put forth his analysis with respect to caste system. Now he analyzed the caste system or what we call a Hindu social order. And I would not like to go into the detail, but make some points as to why he argued out a special policy for the discriminated group of scheduled caste. Now, there are some of the features of the caste that you must understand. And then I'll bring you some international experience also. The feature of the caste, some of the unique feature of the caste are threefold, which you should understand. But the caste system, the way it is laid down in Manusmriti, which was framed in 186 BC, or the caste system or Varna system, which is laid down in Rigveda, Purushottam, in Rigveda, or in Gita, Varnasrama, and several other Hindu texts like Mahabharata and Ramayana. But the basic codification, legal codification came in Manusmriti. So you can get the clear picture from there. Now the first feature of the caste system is that it divides people into groups. The artificial division of the people into groups, and mainly five categories: Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, and their veterans. Prati, Shudra, and the bottom. Now, division of people into group is not a new thing. You can find, if you refer to the Plato's Republic, you find people are being classified into groups based on occupation, based on other constitution. Here, the people are classified and divided into groups, but they are made separate and exclusive through the institution of endogamy and restriction on social relations. The marriage within the caste and restriction on the social relation, interdining, inter-social relation, make this group socially exclusive and not inclusive. Now, besides making, classifying people, making them exclusive, it does another thing, and which is very important, that it also assigns rights, social, economic, political, religious. It assigns right to each of the caste. That also doesn't matter, as long as the rights are equal to each other. But it assigns those rights or make the people entitled to this right in an unequal manner. So the rights are divided or assigned, or people have been made entitled to right in a differential way, in an unequal way. And that is the crux of the caste system. But these rights are not only unequal, but they are also hierarchical and graded. That's very important. And you try to understand this word, hierarchical and graded, because the graded nature of the caste system and hierarchical nature of the caste system is a very unique feature of the caste system, which will help you to partly explain as to why caste like Jat and Patel and Maratha are asking for reservation. Whether there is a case for reservation to them or not, that's another story. But the fact that they ask for reservation, the roots lies in the one of the important features of the caste system, and that is not inequality, but graded inequality. Now, what is graded inequality? Now, the rights across the castes are divided unequally. For example, the Brahmins have the right to learn and teach, and particularly religious scripture. I am talking of classical manusmriti provision. You must understand that. The remnants of it and are still visible in a much more clear way. So the Brahmin's occupation is to learn and teach. And teach religious knowledge, perform ritual, perform sacrifice and charge fee. So it's a profession for the Brahmin. Downfield of the Brahmins are Kshatriya, whose occupation is defense. They have a right to education. Kshatriyas have a right to education in Manusmriti, but they cannot use education as a profession, as a source of income. Downfield of you have Jains, Vaishya, whose occupation is business and enterprises. They too have a right to education, but again they cannot use education as a source of income, as a profession. But Vaishya cannot have a profession of Kshatriya, that is defense, or of a Brahmin, that is education as a profession. Down below you have Shudra, whose the things are not very clear, but generally speaking, the Shudra's occupation was animal husbandry and agriculture. But Shudra did not have right to education. And obviously they did not have right to the occupation of other three castes. At the bottom are the untouchable, or the Shudra, who do not have any right for that matter. They did not have right to agricultural land or enterprises, that is business. And of course, no right to education. But the distinctive features of untouchable is that, so before I come to the untouchable, understand this hierarchical inequality or graded inequality. That Brahmin is put up at the top of the hierarchy, and as you go down, the economic, social, religious right goes down. I have told you the economic and social rights, but there are religious rights which are also unequally divided. Untouchable did not have right to religious practices or religious offering. So as you go down in the caste hierarchy, right get reduced. As you go up, the right get increased. But the key feature is that the right of higher caste are at the cost of denial of those rights to the lower caste. That's very important. And so if the untouchable at the bottom of the caste hierarchy are denied right to education, and others are given right to education, so the others are enjoying right to education at the cost of the denial of right to the lower caste. That one has to understand. I'll come to that later in greater detail. But at this moment, it is good enough for you to understand that caste system is based not only on the principle of inequality, but it is based on principle of grade or hierarchical inequality. And that's why the dealing caste became a lot more difficult problem. Because inequality in the world is bipolar. Worker, capitalist, poor, non-poor, haves, have not, used by different philosophers in different languages. That's not the case here. You get rich and poor, but within the caste system, you have gradation of equality. So everybody suffers except the Brahmin at the top. But suffering of each of the caste is different. The suffering goes down, increases as you go down in the caste hierarchy. That's the feature. And at times it's a borderline. That is why Jat and Patel and Maratha says that we are closer to OBC, we should also need reservation. Had there been only two classes, high caste and low caste, probably would have been much more easy, but that's not the case. Now, the argument that Dr. Ambedkar made is that the caste system essentially denies citizenship right to the untouchables. It also denies some right to the other caste, but untouchables are the whole burden of the caste system falls on the shoulder of the untouchables simply because they don't have any right. Now, the difference between the Shudra and untouchable is very important. The untouchable are not only denied all the rights which the other three, four castes enjoy, but they are also considered to be impure and polluting caste. That's the difference between Shudra and the untouchable. Sometimes called Shudra and Atishudra. That they are considered polluting and they are considered impure, and therefore they are supposed to stay outside the village in a segregated locality, and of course with a social segregation. So even today, if you go to the villages, you will hardly find a village where there is a mixed residence. Untouchable locality will be outside or on the border of the village. So residential segregation is because of their impure character and polluting character. That's the difference. So they are completely excluded socially and residentially, an isolated group from the rest of the community, including Shudra, including Vaishya, including Kshatriya, and of course Brahmin. Now, Dr. Ambedkar argued that if the Government of India Act recognized equal right, civic, political, and particularly civic and political right, and here is a group which is denied equal right, then in that case, they should be given equal right. If everybody is considered citizen, then citizens have their right, then the untouchable who are denied equal right in a society should have equal right. And they are not there in the practice. They may be in the law, but they are not there in the practice. Selectively, the Britishers has introduced the law, equality of law based on individual rights. Education, for example, when they came here, the two, three things that they introduced with respect to education, private property. But there is another thing before I go ahead, that the woman, irrespective of their caste background, were denied several rights. Women were denied right to education, they were denied right to property, they were denied right to religion. So they were fairly close with respect to certain denial, fairly close to the untouchables. And when the Britishers came here and tried to introduce the British law of based on individual rights and citizenship rights, well, they discovered that there are sections in the Indian society which do not have an equal right, and the high caste opposed. So they were in difficulty. I would not like to go into the detail. There is a whole lot of writing, caste and law, by Mark Garrington, Competing Inequality. You should read that book, and there is other writing also. That how in the initial period of the British implementation of their law, they based their law on the Hindu Shastras. They did not interfere into the Hindu Shastras and Islamic law in the state of Bengal. Bengal was the first state to be taken over by the British, and when they introduced the law, they had difficulty. They came with their law system, which was different than the system in here. So they involved Maulavis and the Brahmin to help them to frame the laws, which were essentially, the Hindu laws were basically based on Shastras, which means denial of law to the untouchable and the woman. But gradually they opened up, they brought the concept of private property, they brought the concept of education, and there was huge opposition by the high caste to the education of women and to the untouchable, but they gradually introduced it. In fact, later on they even introduced punishment. You should read the Education Commission of 1921, which tells you entire story, how the effort by the British to provide an equality in education, or admitting the untouchable in the schools, primary school, middle school, was vehemently opposed by the high caste. And so they had to introduce some punishment also. Women were hardly there, very few. Because I remember as a chairman of the UGC, I used to go to various universities, and I went to Calcutta, Madras and Bombay, which had completed 150 years of their establishment. So we had given some money to them, so I went there. The Vice Chancellor, the first thing that they will do is to show me the photograph of a woman. They had framed the photograph of a woman in all the three universities with a great pride, telling me that this was our first student, woman student. And when was that? And that was the 1870, 1880, 1910. As late as that, women began to enter into the education institute. And untouchable came much later. So the denial of right continued even during the British period despite the law. Now the moral of the story is the following. The background of the reservation is following that. Dr. Ambedkar submitted a memorandum to the South Bureau Committee in 1920. Then he repeated that memorandum in the improvised form in 1930, in 1935. Finally, we had a 1935 Act. And also even later on at the time of constitution making, if you want to study the what was the vision of Ambedkar about the Indian constitution, what constitution he wanted, he made several compromises. So you must read State and Minorities. There is a book by him, State and Minorities, The Rights of Minority in the Constitution. It is in the first volume of Ambedkar's writing and speeches, State and Minorities. There, the entire view of Dr. Ambedkar on political democracy, socialism and fundamental rights and protection for minorities and discriminated group is given. He could do something and he could not do all the things. Now, to summarize then, his effort from 1920 to 1937 and 1950, his basic argument was that the social structure of a country has to be taken care of by them framing the constitution. The constitution framing and constitution cannot be independent of social structure, particularly with respect to rights. If the social structure denied the rights, then the constitution has to recognize that and make a provision. And that is what he argued for almost 20 years. And his basic argument was the following, that our social structure based on the caste system deny equal right to the Dalit particularly and to the woman, and therefore there is a need for policy, special policy for them in addition to the general policy. And if you look at the 1920 memorandum and 1930 memorandum, there are four things that were suggested. One is that equality of civic right. There are looked that British recognize the equal citizenship right to everybody. And by the incidence of the birth, if everybody is equal, everybody is entitled to equal right, and untouchable should have an equal right. So the first demand that put before the unprincipled, before the British government, was that unprincipled should have equal right. And then he gave in annexure a whole lot of evidence as to how equal rights are denied to the unprincipled. The second, he said that recognizing to have an equal right is not good enough, but what you require is legal safeguard against the violation of the denial of the right. So you require a law which will provide equality or equal access to the law, but at the same time provide a penal punishment to the person in the event of violation of law or denial of right. So the provision of law, legal safeguard against discrimination. The third provision that he argued, that look, law by itself only has a limited role to play, that it provides only legal safeguard, but it doesn't take care of the consequences of the past exclusion, past discrimination, and also it doesn't provide safeguard to the discriminated groups in employment, in politics, in education institution, in housing, in many other areas. For that you require third steps. So law only prevent, law doesn't cure. Now the consequences of caste on the untouchable and the woman were the following. That since untouchable did not have right to land and right to business, right to enterprises, they were all landless and assetless. They did not have right to education, so they were illiterate. Same is the story with the woman. Woman did not have right to property, so woman did not have property ownership. They were also illiterate because they did not have right to education. Now, law will prevent the discrimination in the present, but how do you take care of the denial of right to property, right to civil right and right to education that was practiced for 2000 years, which resulted into assetlessness and illiteracy among the Dalit and the Umma? So how do you deal with those past denial? Manusmriti was quoted in 186 BC, so almost 2200 years. The woman and the Dalit were denied rights. As a result, on the eve of independence in 1950 or even little earlier to that, what you find that the Dalits were assetless, propertyless, and uneducated, illiterate. In fact, some of the state, you must, as a student of law, some of the state converted the customary law of denial of right to property to untouchable into a formal law. Manusmriti's law was a customary law, which was a very powerful. But he denied. In Punjab, for example, in 1901, an act was passed under which untouchable and even a Brahmin were not allowed to own the land. The reason was, they said that according to the caste is based on occupation, and then those who perform certain occupation, they should have ownership. And if a Jat, but Haryana and Punjab, they are the cultivator, they should have ownership of the land, not to be Brahmin and to the untouchable. So the act was passed, a customary law which denied right to land to the untouchable and the woman and others was converted to a formal law, which was then removed that the act was abolished in 1947 after independence. But for 40 years, untouchable could not buy land, even though they had the money. Because many of the untouchables went into military and they had money, they wanted to buy land, they could not buy land. That is why in Punjab, the proportion of the scheduled caste without land is more than 90%. Good, so look at the statistic of national sample survey. We do not know in how many states the customary law of denial of right and business was converted into a formal law. Now, the consequences of denial were very severe. Now there are two features that I must share with you, that not only does the caste system divide people into groups, not only that it assigns the right in an unequal and a graded manner, but it also provides a mechanism for enforcement, community level mechanism for enforcement if somebody violates the caste code. And that is prescribed in the Manusmriti itself. So you don't require a police to enforce the caste system. Community level policing is very strong, and the remnants of which you can see even today, that how a high caste girl the low caste boy, or other way around, in Haryana, when they dare to marry together, how their families were excommunicated and in some cases they were killed. That's communicable punishment. You imagine 500 years, 1000 years before, what must have been the situation? If this can happen in independent India, the customary rules and norms and custom are so strong that you can't touch it. And endogamy is still a very strong institution, marriage within the caste, dominated by culture because community does the policy. So it is a social ostracism, mechanism of social ostracism, which involved penalties and punishment for women and the low caste for violation of caste, that maintained the caste system for several years. But there is another thing also which Ambedkar argued, and that is that there are moral and ethical principles in Hindu religious philosophy which also support caste system. Because caste system is Hindu social organization. So it's not only a social construct, there are religious principles which support caste system. There are many who disagree. Gandhiji would say, no, untouchability is an appendix to the caste system. It has nothing to do with Hindu philosophy. But Ambedkar gave evidence after evidence. Caste system is supposed to be of a divine origin, which is created from the body of the god. Brahmin from the mouth, Kshatriya from the arm, Vaishya from the knees, and Shudra from the feet. So it's a divine origin. Religion itself played a support. The god himself created the oneness system. And then there are karmas, karma theory and soul theory, which also provide justification. I don't want to explain and take your time. But what you must understand is that the caste system got solidity through the mechanism of enforcement in the form of social ostracism, and secondly, in terms of ethic and moral support from the Hindu religious philosophy. That's why it is a very stubborn institution. Slavery was there for 400 years in America. And many it were abolished, it disappeared within 10 years. Discrimination prevailed, racial discrimination. But slavery, traces of slavery you don't find. We have a law of this untouchability in 1955. Untouchability was there in the constitution. And then followed, there was a law. Untouchability is still very rampant. So one has to find out a question as to why there is a law against untouchability. And yet untouchability is practiced in a much larger way, on a large scale. That is because of the, it is a social institution and it has a support, it's a religious institution also. That is why it is not more stubborn. But anyway, that is, that you must understand. The major point is that Ambedkar argued that insofar as caste involved denial of equal right, he argued that first we accept that everybody has equal civic right, second that there should be a legal protection against equal right, and third therefore he said that to ensure equal participation in employment and politics and in education, there should be some method whereby he ensures the appropriate representation. And if not by any other proportion, by proportion of population. And therefore that is what we call reservation. The representation of the discriminated group in employment, in education, in politics, because otherwise it would not happen. Caste system prevailed, otherwise it would not happen. And there are past consequences also of denial of education, so you are compensating also, and that they will get an equal share and participation, at least having proportion to the population. There are two examples before us, that if you don't have representation mechanism for representation, there can be a huge under-representation. Muslim is one. When their representation was taken out, separately looked at. Now they constitute about 14% of India's population, they account only 5% in the parliament. Women constitute half of the India's population, they are only 10% in the parliament. Gender discrimination. Because in society there is a gender discrimination, society there is a discrimination associated with religion and caste. And as a result, the democracy is not based on fair representation, it is based on communalism. It is based on caste and community. So therefore, for the discriminated group, you do require a mechanism whereby you ensure them the proper representation. Now we use the word reservation and we set the quota. Other countries, there are, I think, at least I know, 10 to 15 countries. I think you have USA, the equality, equal opportunity policy, they also take into account the black population, but not as explicitly as we do. But when they see the underrepresentation, they look at the figure of black population. On Northern Ireland, the fight is between the Protestant and the Catholic, so they have equal employment opportunity policy. There also they try to see that both the group have an equal proportion in proportion to their population. In Pakistan, there is a reservation in politics for the woman. We don't have it, they have. They are far progressive as far as the political reservation for women is concerned. Then you go to China, there are 56 minorities, there is affirmative action policy there. In party, in communist party, there should be a due representation to these minorities in employment, in education. Well, I can go on and on. Malaysia, South Africa, New Zealand, Australia, Thailand. So all the countries we suffered, where we have minority, we suffered from discrimination. We have find out policies and the ways and means whereby you ensure some representation to the discriminated group. But also you give these facilities to compensate for the denial in the past. Now, this is the logistic, this is the reason that Ambedkar provided, and that is why it was accepted by the British, that is why later on when we got the constitution, we made the provision in the constitution. Now, constitutions guarantee fundamental right. Constitution recognized principle of equality and as a result principle of non-discrimination. Equality, irrespective of caste, religion, color, ethnic background, religion, whatever, believe in equality, and therefore we make everybody entitled to equal right. But directive principle put an additional responsibility on the state. You are aware about the provision in the directive principle. It is not enforceable in the court of law, but directive principle are the direction to the state that in framing the policies and the law, they should keep certain thing in mind. The directive principle recognize the problem in this society, that is, everybody should have an equal status, everybody should have equal facilities, everybody should have equal opportunities. And the government, while framing the laws and the policies, should see to it that we ensure equal status, equal facilities and equal opportunities. Directive principle also put a special responsibility on the government that the economic and educational interest of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe should be taken care of and they should be protected from social injustices and exploitation. These are the wording in the directive principle if you have read it. So I think I just want to summarize by saying that not only in India but several countries in the world where you have minorities which suffered exclusion and discrimination, in addition to the general policies, there are special policies which are created to provide an equal access, a similar access and equal right to the discriminated group. Associated with race, color, gender, region, ethnic background, indigenous name and many other characteristics. So that is how the reservation policy we have developed. At a political level, it has got an overwhelming support, that is why Constitutional Assembly accepted it, both banning of patentability and provision of reservation. And we keep on extending political reservation hour for 10 years, but other reservations do not have a time limit. But we keep on extending it because there is, at a political level, there is a consensus, at least for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. There were huge differences of opinion in case of OBC. And yet we arrive at a conclusion that at least criminal air can be excluded, but the most poor and educationally and economically backward can be given some space. Now there is again huge debate about the other group which are asking for reservation. Now I make one or two points and then I think we can discuss the answer question will be much better. The point is that there is a growing demand by various groups. And why there is a growing demand by various groups for reservation and how to deal with it. To be very frank, I don't have an answer to this question, but I'll share you my reflection on this. One of the reasons why some of the groups are coming forward and asking for reservation Not that we don't have pro-poor policies, we have those policies, but reservation policy is a supplementary and complementary to the pro-poor policy. There is a growing demand by several groups, because in the process of the economic development in the last 50-60 years, some of the groups have benefited unequally. Everybody has benefited, but some benefited more and some benefited less. And some of those who benefited less, they think that they are excluded in the development process, so we should have representation in employment, representation in other sphere, and therefore we should have the policy similar to that of the scheduled class. Now this is a very difficult task. How do you consider and how do you object to it? I have given some thought to it, and the insight that you get from the feature of the caste are very important. What you see is that other than the high caste, the Brahmin caste, all other castes suffer from some degree of discrimination. That's a very typical feature of caste system. Kshatriya suffer from the discrimination from the Brahmin. Brahmin suffered, the Vaishya suffered some discrimination from the Vaishya, from Kshatriya. But Kshatriya discrimination is less than that of Vaishya. Shudra suffered some discrimination, but their discrimination is more than Vaishya. Vaishya discrimination is less than Shudra in terms of denial of rights. Remember that. And the discrimination and exclusion of untouchable is the highest. So, every caste except the high caste suffered from degree of discrimination. But the degree of discrimination and denial and their intensity is different. The highest intensity is in the case of untouchable, possibly those come to the OBCs, and then perhaps Vaishya also face, Kshatriya also face to some extent. And therefore, there is a feeling of asking for a similar protection emerge among certain groups. Women, for example, they feel that because of gender, they are excluded in the political process. And that is why for several years they didn't realize, but now they realize that there is a gender discrimination in the political electoral process. So they want to share, if not half a 50%, but at least a 13%. Now, where do we draw the line? One ideal choice is that each caste give according to their population share. Make it representative participation. Many countries have, Germany has. Now it's a very tricky issue. My feeling on this is that I need to give more thought to it, but my feeling is that the communities, the caste, in which case discrimination is such that it resulted into lack of asset like land and industry and education, they would possibly need reservational support. But there are castes, I won't name, there are castes who also discriminate to a certain extent, but they are not deprived of land, they are not deprived of access to industry, they are not deprived of access to education. Maybe they are little less educated than the others, but they have this main resource of land and industry and human resource in terms of education. But they face some discrimination. In such situation, I think the case for reservation is weak. There are general policy, there are arguments, there are problems, but the general pro-poor policy will be good enough. If you are lacking in education, you can make use of education because you have land and you have industry. Your sources of income, whereby you can get an access to education and good education. So I think the criteria for considering of some claim, some space, should be that whether you are was discrimination so strong that you did not have access to asset, education and even civil right, and that is only the case in case of untouchables and to some certain extent economically, educationally backward caste to whom we have given the reservation. The rest I do not know really. because all other communities have enough of ownership of asset, access to industry, education is not debarred, in fact they own education institution. So I think there, the general poor policy, wherever group specific policy, wherever they are weak, you help them through a general policy. I think that this is what I began to think. Well, there are, if you want me to go to the argument against reservation, there are many of them, and if you are interested, please read my article in EPW, very latest in EPW, Prejudice Against Reservation, How and Why. I think it is possibly 20th of April. Not April, 20th of, this is February, isn't it? 20th of February, EPW. So all detail is given there. Well, the arguments are that that reservation policy is not helping poor, it's helping relatively better off among certain class. And if the relatively better off, in any case, we have access to education and job because they have good education among certain class, why don't you need the reservation? That the reservation leads to inefficiency. That reservation has not brought much change because there is a rampant poverty among scheduled caste. And that how long this reservation will continue. These are some of the arguments which are made, and with respect to scheduled caste I am talking about. I am not talking about other group. I think most of these arguments are not based on, or recent argument that the reservation should be based on economic criteria rather than caste. So these are some of these arguments. Most of these arguments are not based on empirical reality or theory. Those arguments which are not based on empirical reality are the following. That reservation has not helped much to reduce the poverty of the scheduled caste. This is not correct. If you take employment reservation, for example, out of the total regular salaried job in the country, out of the total regular salaried job to which the reservation is applied, only 18% are in government. Rest are in private. And then even out of 18% or 20% you may like to call it, there are 40% job, government jobs which are on contract. A very small proportion of the government jobs are applicable to reservation. So very small proportion of the scheduled caste get the job because rest of it is 80% in private and some of them are in contract where there is no reservation. So a very small proportion of the scheduled caste get a job. Only out of 18%, maybe 15% regular salary job, government, there is a reservation, which is very tiny. As a result, its consequences of the scheduled caste will also be less, unless you include whole coverage. I have given the statistic in that article that poor have benefited hugely from reservation. The argument that only rich have benefited is not correct. If you take, for example, central government A, B, C, D, and C and D is class 3 and class 4, 80% of the posts occupied by the government scheduled caste in the reservation are class 3 and class 4. They are all poor. They are not from the top section. So I think these arguments are empirically are not correct. I'll take only one, and there is a note here that we should better have discussion, more discussion rather than I am giving lectures. That's good. I'll take only one argument and I'll stop. That is that economic criteria should be the basis of the reservation. I think this is also an argument which is very flawed. That is, that discrimination and exclusion is not based on your economic condition, poverty. It is based on your identity. Women were denied right to property, right to education, not because they were poor, but because they are women. Same is the case with the gender, same is the case with race, same is the case with color. So exclusion and discrimination against which there is a reservation policy or affirmative action policy is to deal with the discrimination which is not based on poverty, it's based on the identity of the person. And therefore, if you are discriminated based on your identity, then you have to be you have to take identity as a criteria for affirmative action and not the economic standard. There is one point though, which the critics mention, and that is that to which I agree, that all those middle class who are economically better off, they should not be given subsidizing financial concessions, a fee waiver or anything, no, because they can afford to pay. But as far as reservation is concerned, they would also need reservation because they are also discriminated. High class discriminated the scheduled caste, irrespective of their economic background, poor or rich. And you require a protection, then legal and otherwise, on the basis of the caste, ethnicity, religion, gender, and not on the basis of economics. So there are other arguments which we can take. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the tremendous insight into the history and contemporary situation of reservation policy. Now I invite questions. I kindly request all of you to keep the questions short and avoid shows talking about the question.
Sir, do I ask? Hello, sir. My name is Amrit Ansh and I'm a final year student at the university. I am confused and you can help me with this. So when you started, you said that there are certain castes in terms of access to land, access to education, which can be excluded from the reservation scenario. You said that there are certain castes who have access to land, who have access to educational opportunity, that can be excluded from the reservation context. But
not
when you...
Not excluded, their demand.
Yeah, their demand can be...
We should consider their demand to be included into the reservation. That's the point.
Sir, so, I am saying when you said that when you are considering demand for reservation in case,
right,
in case of caste, then you should be looking at factors like access to land, access to education.
Right,
but
exactly.
When you ended your conversation, you said that economics is not a criterion on which a reservation should be given.
Right.
Is there a contradiction in this or am I confusing anything?
Okay. There is no contradiction. It looks contradictory, but it is not. The reason is the intensity of discrimination varies significantly. You take OBC and, for example, caste above OBC. The discrimination that they face dramatically vary from the discrimination that the untouchable face. So there is, what I say is that in the caste system, every caste face some degree of discrimination. But that discrimination, which is severe and debarred you from having a ownership of land and enterprises and education, that discrimination is more severe, and the group which suffered from that discrimination are the cases, are the suitable candidate for the affirmative action policy. But the caste, which also suffered a little bit from the discrimination, but that discrimination is not as intense as to make you assetless, educationless, then in that case, the case for reservation is weak. That's what I said. And there are communities, for example, Kshatriya face discrimination from the head of the Brahmin, isn't it? Or the Vaishya face discrimination from others. But their intensity and degree of discrimination is not such that they deprive of all ownership of asset and make them poverty and marginalized. So that is the bottom line. But in case of scheduled castes, discrimination is so intense that they have no asset, no education, no civil right, and they require special protection. And there is a other thing that they are in minority against the high caste majority.
Good evening, sir. I am Deepak Inge from third year of this college. My question was, the Dalits in India who get reservation are only those who are covered under the Hindu religion. The Dalits who earlier converted to Islam or Christianity due to the social factors or the economic factors which have been accused of, can we really say that our perception of equality is complete when we have left a huge portion of population who were Dalits earlier but later converted to Islam and were not given the benefits of the reservation? Can we say that these people are not being given the benefit which they deserve? Thank you.
See, listen, if you take the international experience or Indian experience also, the religion has not been the basis of reservation. In many cases, we bypass the religion. Although the reservation is confined to the caste which are part of Hinduism or Hindu social organization. But we give the reservation to the settled caste converted to Sikhism. Right in 1950, remember when? Master Tara Singh argued with Nehru that in case you do not give reservation to scheduled caste converted to Sikhism, all Sikh scheduled caste Sikh will convert to Hinduism, because there was a thin line. And so the Majbi Sikh and Sikh converted to scheduled caste converted to Sikhism were given reservation on par with the Hindu scheduled caste. The scheduled caste converted to Buddhism in 1956 under the leadership of Ambedkar, they were arguing and they got reservation in 1991. And P.P. Singh and Paswan were in the power. So they get reservation. The only communities which converted to other religion like Islam and Christianity, they are not entitled because there was no, the Hindu consideration is still there, I can agree with you. But they have been making the cases and the constitution does become obstacle. But you may know that for OBC, there is a very substantial portion of Muslim OBC which are included under the OBC category. But theoretically speaking, we have created this barrier of religion, but theoretically speaking, the basic thing for reservation policy is there is nothing else. Nothing can justify reservation or affirmative action policy, and that's the only thing is discrimination associated with your identity. Otherwise, if you are poor, then there can be a policy for removing poverty. So discrimination is the only consideration. It's a different matter that constitution may have a provision where it's confined to those who are within the domain of the Hindu community. But that's not the correct way of looking at it. Discrimination is discrimination. Women, for example, whether Hindu or Muslim or Sikh or Christians, they all suffer. You cannot say that we will give the protection to one section and remove the others. So discrimination is the bottom line and main consideration for these policies. That is why I say that the caste which suffered from discrimination much less, although they suffer because caste hierarchy is like that, but who suffered less, and it doesn't result into their marginalization, deprivation in ownership of asset and education, they have a much less case for affirmative action policy.
Ritesh, and then
Arutra,
and then
Chita.
Good evening, sir. I'm Pritesh from the second year. So, towards the end of your speech, when you spoke about economic discrimination as a ground for reservation, you said that certain communities were discriminated against because of their caste identity, as a consequence of which, I assume you agree that they were denied social and political rights, and which we remedy by giving them the same social and political rights through their reservation. So, which makes me think that poverty and this very lack of social and political rights would also count as a factor, as a sufficient factor for getting reservation and not just the caste identity. I mean to say that poverty also forms a basis of identity and not just caste.
No, I don't understand what you are trying to say. As far as the political and civil rights are concerned, everybody has political rights, right to vote. Social rights, I do not know which are the social rights which are denied to the caste other than the scheduled caste. I don't think they are denied social rights. They have equal access to all public facilities in the village and everywhere. But there are shades of discrimination that they do face, but we don't have study. But I do believe that based on the theoretical reading, one understands that every caste suffers from some degree of discrimination. But whether they require protection or not will depend on the degree of discrimination, whether that lands them into marginalization or not, complete marginalization. Now, I agree with you that poverty and discrimination are the same thing. No. Poverty, what is this? What are the sources of poverty? Sources of poverty that you don't have sources of income, you don't have land, you don't have enterprises, you don't have education, as a result you don't have good jobs. those are the basically the factors that cause poverty. Okay. In case of discriminated group, also the same factor cause poverty. But the mechanism and channel through which they became poor, they became assetless and less education, is discrimination, which is not the case with the high caste. Remember well, high caste don't face discrimination. Imagine you are a graduate now, a Dalit boy and a high caste boy, both enter into the market. You have taken education on equal par. There is a discrimination in the market. There are a large number of studies which brings out the discrimination in the urban labor market. High caste student will, on the contrary, will benefit from the social network that he or she has. While the scheduled caste will face discrimination. Now you require protection. I did a study which became very, very famous. And that study is called correspondence study. If you are interested, read my book, Blog by Caste, brought out by Oxford. I did it in collaboration with somebody in Princeton University. What we did, we had a four pair of students, applicant, a scheduled caste, a Muslim, a high caste. And the fourth player was, pair was high caste and Dalit combined. All of them have the identical qualification. Family background, language background, parent background, all same. The fourth pair was that the Dalit was postgraduate, master, and Brahmin was undergraduate, BA. Over a period of 1 year, we responded to all advertisements for the job, which came in Hindu, Indian Express around 4 or 5 days. What is the difference between them? Everything is same except the name. One was Paswan, other was Salim, and third was Chakravarti, Tripathi, and fourth pair was Tripathi and the Paswan. But Brahmin has low qualification, untouchable is a high qualification. What do you find? The propensity of getting the job call for interview was 65% less for the Dalit, 35% less for the Brahmin, for the Muslim. Compared to the high caste with a similar qualification. But what is surprising is that in the last pair, where the Brahmin is less educated and the Dalit is higher educated, there also the Brahmin, proportion of Brahmin receiving interview call was higher than that of Dalit who were came in. But there are many other studies. I mean, you should read articles by Madheshwaran, which have examined the discrimination in employment. Our employment market, private sector doesn't accept it, but it is discriminatory in nature. I don't want to give you data and bore you with the data, but you should go to Pune and look at the caste composition of the employees in Kirloskar. You should look at the caste composition of the Reliance, I don't know, regional composition. So this is not to say that there is no respect for merit. There is a respect for merit because they would not like to run their business with less qualification. But the supply being more, you prefer the meritorious from your own caste and from more religion and from your own group. So ultimate indication is not the indicator is not the merit. I'll give you one more example and then stop. Ambedkar had created employment exchange. What are the transparent way of giving information about job? Employment exchange. That every employer should get application from employment exchange. That employer should give advertisement in the newspaper so that everybody has an opportunity to know the job and apply and compete. At the moment, friends, only 6 to 7% of recruitment, or at the most 10 to 15%, are made through advertisement in the newspaper or employment exchange. Rest are all informal. We have created new mechanism of recruitment, on-campus recruitment. We take pride in that. Is on-campus recruitment is a competitive mechanism? The National Law School will give the list to the company of the first 15 or 20, and that is the best for them. But if you give an advertisement and allow the competition to be held at all India level, there is no necessity that the student which comes in the first 15 or 20 from this university will be selected. It's a highly discriminatory recruitment. Similarly, website, naukri.com. What do you do? You put up your bio data and you don't know the person. He can send the invitation interview call to somebody who belongs to his village, belongs to his district, belongs to his caste and religion. Similarly, the recruitment to the agencies. What does the university does for class 3 and class 4 for security? I also do in my Indian Council of Social Sciences. So if I need 2 security men, we just ask the agent to send the names. He will send you 3-4 names based on the qualification that we ask for. But we do not know that they are the best one. They may be the relatives and from the same district of the agency. So we have developed a recruitment mechanism which are not egalitarian recruitment methods. So private sector recruitment face a lot of issues as far as the discrimination is concerned. And those who are weak, those do not have their network, caste, religion, or other network, they lag behind. Yes?
Good evening, sir. Thank you so much for the talk. It broke a lot of uninformed and preconceived notions.
Please hold closer to your mouth.
Yeah, sir, it broke a lot of uninformed and preconceived notions. So my question to you is, in one of the segments of your talk, you said that the reason that reservation policy has received extension after extension by the government is testimony to consensus. However, don't you think that is contrary to the intention behind reservation, where it was meant to merge a particular set of people into society rather than keeping them at a higher pedestal as compared to others? So the question being, is refusing that time capsule and extending it contrary to the intention behind reservation, which was conceptualized when it was put into place?
Right, you have a very important question, and that relates to how long the reservation policy will continue. That's the question debatedly asked. What is the purpose of reservation? And why reservation? Oh, the reservation is there because certain groups continue to suffer from discrimination, despite the law, despite the provision in constitution, despite the law, they continue to face discrimination because our society is discriminatory in nature. Now, some discrimination do not have much consequences except the dignity, you know. You are not allowed to fetch water from the same tap. You are not allowed to go into the temple. Those are the issues of dignity. But the discrimination in education, discrimination in employment, discrimination in politics are something which marginalize you, something which lead to poverty. So discrimination has a consequence. And to overcome those consequences and give them the equal participation and equal right, and also bring them on par with other is the objective. Now, so any withdrawal, any exit of reservation policy has to be judged by two things. One, is discrimination is a thing of past and everybody get an equal right? And secondly, has the gap between the discriminated and non-discriminated group been reduced to a manageable extent? In Japan, they have. So the reservation policy in Japan has been withdrawn in 2000. There is a Borakuman, which is a discriminated group, ethnic group. Reservation has been withdrawn. But they have conclusively proved that the Borakuman has now subsumed into a larger Japanese society and they face much less discrimination. Can we say about the same thing in India? You can't. And I have given you two examples, woman and the Muslim in politics. Why are women asking for political reservation? But there is a discrimination in the political process, electoral process. Muslim lag behind, there is a discrimination in political process. Untouchable and the Adivasis are able to get 16% and 8% in parliament simply because their seats are reserved. So as long as discrimination prevails in a significant degree, I am not saying marginal is okay, but in significant degree, in those areas where the material development is necessary, you will have to give a protection. You cannot say that we withdraw it just like that. You have to give a protection. You cannot say that we allow them to discriminate. That violates the constitution, that violates the law. Now, as far as reservation in India is concerned, it is only political reservation which has to be renewed after 10 years. Reservation in education and employment has to be reviewed based on the gap being reduced, and that we have developed a mechanism whereby discrimination doesn't prevail. Now, so those are the considerations. Because you know, the reason is, the discrimination in this country is not an ordinary thing. It is a very intense and it's a historical for several years. I can understand the new generations problem. I was the chairman of the UGC, and students used to come to me. And they continue to come to me now also. The non-scheduled caste student comes and they would ask a reasonable question, that by giving reservation to the scheduled caste, there are some of us who have little more percentage than there, we are not getting admission. So this is a reverse discrimination. Now the argument is genuine. Now the argument that youth has to do, the argument that youth should take is the following. They should then say that look, this Sharukas group are discriminated and therefore they need preference. But at the same time, expand the facilities in a manner that others are not deprived. So we need more universities. We need more endowment. We create an artificial scarcity by not expanding the colleges and the university, and then build up this argument that they are given and we are deprived. When we had a reservation, I was instrumental, I mean I was asked to implement the OBC reservation in 2008 because I am chairman of UGC. We took that decision on purpose. That by giving 27% reservation to OBC, what will happen to the OBC 27? So Arjun Singh said, create 27% more positions. We will give more funding. We give the funding for faculty, for student, for infrastructure. So I think we will have to treat equally. But the non-Sharuka student should not oppose on the argument that their rights are deprived. Yes, their rights are deprived. For their right, facility should be expanded. But a realization and sensitivity should be there that if the high caste have a high proportion of education, Brahmins and Kshatriyas have high proportion of education, and that they are able to capture the jobs in the market, because remember when? Because the education has been confined for thousands of years to a particular community at the cost of denial of education to the other. So when certain sections monopolize the education and make them eligible, then there is a limited stock of people being educated and they get the job. So remember well that the advancement of the higher caste through education and employment is at the cost of the impoverishment of the low caste. Now, young student will say, I am not responsible, my forefather was responsible. No. The privileges are transferred through the generations. From generation to generation, and education is confined. You are the beneficiaries of those privileges. And so you cannot say that I am not responsible. You are responsible, so we have to take it responsibility. Therefore, in the United Nations principle, you are a student of law, the principle of compensation and repression is used. Reservation is not used many times. There is a legal case of reservation for those who were denied equal right, and they were denied equal right for the privileges of some. So there is a legal case for reparation, and several communities have been given reparation. Jews were compensated by the German. Japanese who were displaced and put in concentration camp during the Second World War by the USA, they were given compensation. The Korean woman, which was subject to sexual exploitation by the military, Japanese military, they were given some compensation. Now here are the who are denied right to property, right to education, and normal civil right and isolated, they need to be given compensation. And there are people who benefited at the cost of theirs. So I think this larger argument should be understood. And what we have to do is to develop this sensitive attitude and develop a balanced policy. As I say, increase the universities, increase the colleges, so that whosoever is deserved and eligible to get admission should not be denied high caste because other guests. But the high caste should also be very sensitive that look, these people were denied right for several years. They need to have some space, some sympathies. Now there are issues, for example, many of them come and they come from rural area. They come from the families where English is not taught. So there are elite students, there are less elite students. So they need academic support, which should be given. We in JNU, Jawaharlal Nehru University, over a period of time, we have developed a remedial system. In the initial, it failed, but later on it succeeded. We developed what is called personalized academic assistance. And this is for both Sharukas, whosoever is there, who is coming with the Hindi language, we give them academic assistance. What is the academic assistance? That in the MA class or MPhil class, there is a coordinator, academic coordinator. He observes the grade of the student in the very first semester. And those who are weak, those who get less grade, they are identified, and politely the concerned teacher is asked to give them more attention. And the senior students are attached to that student. And as a result, they are able to recover their deficiencies. In fact, some of those students who got assistant did better than the other. So you require a very sensitive and positive attitude to give them support, not only scheduled caste, but those who are coming from rural area, those who are coming in Hindi language, those who are coming from a less economically better of background, so not having an access to English education. They all need to be supported. Remember well, our enrollment ratio is only 25% in the higher education. And newer classes are coming. And they are coming from families and others where they have a less backup of good education. They need to be supported in the higher education institution. In 191 and 1920, when the British opened the colleges, St. Stephen College, Hindu College here, Deccan College there, who were the students? Brahmin male from urban area. And then gradually the Brahmin female, then the Muslim, then the scheduled caste, then from rural area. So we have a diversified section of population which is present on the higher education campuses. And they come with all kinds of ideologies and others, that's another matter. But they come with a very academic background. So those who come from a different background, they may get the minimum qualification, of course. Not that they do not. But with that minimum qualification, when they enter with certain handicap, which we should support them. And in an experimented manner, and it can help them. So we have to deal with this issue in the larger interest of our country.
Thank you so much, sir, for the question. If there are two more questions,
So, I was wondering if you could elaborate on the relationship between endogamy and land.
Endogamy?
And land.
Land?
Yes, sir. You were talking
about... Okay. No, I don't know the question fully. Endogamy is... basically very simple, that's marriage within the caste. You cannot marry outside. Exogamy is married outside the caste. So endogamy essentially means marriage within the caste. You understand that? It's clear? But land relation, I'm not quite clear, but I can independently tell you that land means the woman did not have a right to property. The man used to have a right to property. It's Ambedkar who brought the Hindu code in 1952, I don't know, you were aware for that. So he not only fought for the Dalit cause and tribal, but also woman. So he through the Hindu court, he brought the right to property, right to diamond, right to inheritance, all those rights. And so much so that his whole entire bill was not accepted at a time. It became an installment, so he resigned as a law minister. So committed to woman's right. So these were the provisions of the Hindu, old Hindu act. And the Hindu court bill gives them the equal rights that you have now. I don't know whether I made your question.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I invite Dr. Sushila to kindly hand over the moment to Dr. Sushila. Thank you for joining us today.